Now let us continue with part two. We left off with a 15-year-old M’Jaie as she told the story of the time her father left her on the side of the road, all alone.
We're driving through the city and then we're driving out of the city and I'm like, the mall's that way.
Yeah. where Daddy.
and then we started hitting a country road and I still remember he had an El Camino and I still remember, you know, the shocks or whatever, and the bounce. And he pulled over on the side of the road. We're in the middle of nowhere. Mm-hmm. And he says, get out. And I'm like, what? You know, I think he's joking. He's like, get out. I'm like, you know, I'm trying to have like this nervous laughter, like, wait, what?
Yeah.
You know, are you joking? And he reaches over and he pulls open the door and he pushes the door open and he says, get out. And he starts pushing me out the door. And I'm getting, I'm like, what is happening?
Get ready for the real estate show that takes you across the barriers and into the danger zone. That Bitchin' Real Estate Podcast with your host, Tenacious T.
You have no idea where you are.
I don't know where I'm at. I know
is it dark?
This is in, you know, Toledo, Ohio. And no, but it was getting dark. It was probably like 3 or 4 in the afternoon, evening, and I get out of the car and I look in and I'm like waiting for him to crack a smile, and he doesn't, and he drives off, and I'm sitting there like,
what the fuck
is happening?
What the fuck? Yeah,
and I'm watching the car and I'm like, it's getting smaller. I'm waiting. I'm looking at it like, is he gonna turn around?
Yeah.
And it just completely went out of my vision. It was gone.
Yeah.
I'm on the side of the road, like, I mean, as dumbfounded as you are now.
Yeah.
I was.
I can't imagine. I really can't imagine. Other than not only confusion, but terrifying.
It was terrifying. It was confusion. It was lots of things. And all I knew, I saw this other truck coming down the road, and I was like, oh, I think I know what I'm supposed to do.
Yes.
Go on the other side of the road.
So, gorgeous little teenage girl.
Yeah.
Alone. It's getting dark, and you have to fucking hitchhike.
Yeah, I'm like, I think, you know, something already transpired at that moment when I decided to walk across the street and put my thumb out. The truck pulls over, and there's two men in the truck. Mm. And they're like, what are you doing out here? And I'm like, oh, my dad left me.
Yeah, like they even believed that.
I even knew how f***ed up the world was, that anything could have happened at that point.
Right.
This doesn't end in a horrifying, you know, story. But
she's so here. She didn't get killed.
But so they're like, okay. So they let me in the truck, and I remember. And at any time I think about this, and I really didn't think about this for so many years. It was when I went through therapy that this came up. I can still feel being in between them right now. I can feel their energy, and I always want to thank you so much.
They did the right thing.
Yes, but they got me in the truck, and they're like, "Where do you want to go?" And I sat there for a second, and I was like, I still have the ticket to the Kiss concert in my back pocket.
Yeah. Love it.
I want to go to the Kiss concert. And they're like, okay. So they take me and they drop me off. And back, there's no phones, you know.
Yeah.
There was no, I get in this general admission ticket to Kiss concert. My first concert, and
but she had a hitchhike.
And I'm like, okay, and somehow that moment I end up in I'm in general admission, but I end up in the front row.
Nice.
And I'm watching this and I'm like, oh my god,
yeah,
this is awesome. And then long story short, from the front row I actually make it to, I don't even know who I was hanging out with. I'm 15. I'm not drinking. I'm not doing anything like that. You know, don't really have any money. And we end up, these people that I'm with, anyways, we end up at the hotel that Kiss is actually supposed to be staying at. And I'm like, what is going on in my life? And I start walking down this hall and I look up and f***ing Gene Simmons is as close to me as you are.
I love it.
I'm like,
I know. Was he still in costume?
No. I was like, he's like, hey. And I'm like, I just saw you at the kids' concert. He's like, yeah.
Hi.
I'm Jing. And I'm like, oh my God. And then nobody was really at the hotel. There was only a couple other people, and there was like four. But next thing I know, we're sitting there. He's on, because I was walking down the hall and he was taking the steps down. Mm-hmm. And so we're like, this, he's there, and I'm here. And I'm like, oh. So he sits down on the edge of the stairs, you know, like, he's like,
and he's Gene Simmons.
Oh my God. And then who else turns the corner? Guess. Paul Stanley. And I'm like, what the? And I ended up hanging, and he, Paul, they're like, you know, staggered from each other, sitting on the, they're hanging out with their fans. I'm 15. They're not wanting anything crazy. They're just hanging out and connecting.
Good guys.
Yes.
Good guys.
They just wanted to connect with us because we had made it. We were the few the people that actually made it to them. It's about 45 minutes. They gave us their time. And I even remember Paul Stanley, he was chewing a piece of gum and there was a little thing right over here and he went to go put his gum on the thing. And when he left, I went and I grabbed the gum because I'm 15 and it's Paul Stanley's gum. And I held on to that forever. But that was my first experience, what I call the magic carpet ride.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that in that moment when I was on the other side of the street, my father was trying to correct me. Whatever way he was trying, he didn't know how to raise a child. He was trying to get a message through, but I wasn't taking it.
Right.
And I wasn't going to accept it. And that's why I became MJ. I made up my mind that I wasn't going to be a victim.
Yes.
I made up my mind that I was going to get through this.
Yes.
And I didn't need anybody.
Except
for the two guys in the truck.
I love it.
But the universe brought me them.
Yes.
I don't even know where the fuck they were going, but the universe brought me them. And that is where I became MJ, the one that is here today. That is what showed me that all you have to do is use your mind. And that was, I was taken on a magic carpet ride because of just the switch.
Believing
in something, wanting something, not accepting something. Of course, I had to disconnect and become something else because it was traumatizing.
And what a beautiful example of, you had the vision of going to the concert. You had the vision of, you know, going shopping, but that's not what was given you.
No.
It was the up and down of that road and being able to tap back into yourself and save yourself, because no one is going to save you.
Nobody's going to save you. And I wouldn't go back and change that moment for anything, because that's who I am. And Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley's, those experiences happen in my life all the time because I was shown that I can be and do anything it is. And this just comes to me. And
law of attraction.
There's nothing inside of me that tells me that I can't experience anything that I want to experience or be what it is that I want to be. It's magic to me.
During one of our sessions, you said that anything is possible.
Mm-hmm.
Anything is possible. And when I'm in certain situations, I hear your voice. I do. I hear your voice. And it's true. It's true. Anything is possible. It doesn't mean that it's easy. Nothing good comes easy. But anything is possible.
The biggest compliment to me is what you just said, saying that you hear my voice.
I do.
Just the other day, Ricky and I went to dinner, and a coaching client that I hadn't, he kind of fell off, you know, for about 6 months. I hadn't heard from him, and he just messaged me out of the blue, and he said, I want to let you know how much you've helped me. I drew my boundaries with something, and I won, and he said, I would have never been able to without you teaching me the self-love and teaching me the strength and power in that. And I'm just like, wow, you coach people and then people go out into the world. And when you realize that your two souls were brought together for the purposes of changing it and making sure that you get on track.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's something that I'm touched by that I'll never forget, you know,
it's
these moments. Yeah, it is. But it's a blessing for both of us. And that's when that's what keeps me going.
Yeah.
That's what keeps me going. When me hearing you say that, especially for everybody else to hear it, it's like super special to me that it's like,
it's
I got to keep on going and doing what it is that I got to do and connecting the message out there. Self-love. That's where you draw your power from.
And this is the time for it.
Absolutely.
Humanity has reached a point where we have forgotten what love feels like. Real love, true love, self-love, agape love.
Mm-hmm.
You are fortunate enough to have the love of many lifetimes in your life.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't believe that comes into your life until you love yourself enough to allow it?
Oh, I had to love myself before my relationship currently, because you just get to a point that, I mean, it's true what they say. You can't love anybody else until you love yourself.
Yeah.
It's just all superficial stuff. And you just don't accept things. Once you love yourself, once you get to that place, you don't accept the bullshit.
Right.
And your standards are completely different. You raise the bar, and you're not willing to go back to feeling like, you know, how you ever did before.
Right. Because you know your self-worth.
There's true value. There's self-worth there. And you don't spend that just on anybody at all.
Nope.
And so, yes, it was just, I think about that all the time. If I met Ricky 2 years previous, I would have been all ego.
You wouldn't have been ready for him.
I would have been, because I was always like, you're just lucky to be sitting right there. And if you didn't like it, there's a bunch of men over there that would love to take your place.
Well, they are lucky to sit next to her. The energy even right now, I'm like, oh, this is so delicious.
No, but the mentality
yes,
of
the
that
mentality
is all
of
ego.
It, yeah.
And it's like, how would anybody want to sit next to somebody who thought you need to be, you know.
I've sat next to some people like that. Yeah.
So it's once I got rid of that, and because I had to face myself again, you know, it was through therapy and my art, and I was like, you know what, this is who I am. I've always been me, but when I decided that things just had to go that no longer served me, then that's when my full power and potential came
out.
That's
breaking away of that crust that we all have.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm going to push us into the famous questions. And you had a chance to answer these before, previously on my show.
Here is a little snippet from 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm. So I have a couple of quick famous questions.
Oh my gosh.
I'd like to ask you.
I'm still trying to figure out the one you asked earlier.
Which, yes, this is her comeback special. or maybe it's mine. We're going to focus on... I do love Elvis, especially in the leather that he... I don't know if you've ever seen his comeback special. And if you haven't... Okay. If you haven't seen Elvis Presley in the comeback special when he came back and he was in all leather... That's all I'm going to say.
Love it.
Thinking of the divine feminine, what is your favorite word? Oh, yes. Yes.
It's always been there. I don't know. I hope.
There is something
about it.
About being able to openly express your sensuality and sexuality with your love, your lover, and not apologize for it and have it embraced. Mm-hmm. It feels good. Feels good. I love it. So what is your least favorite word?
Probably can't.
Can't. Yes.
Yeah,
I can't do that. I can't wear those boots. Yes, you can, and you're going to look good in them. Right?
Yeah.
Yes. Well, I think I already know the answer to this one.
What? Again, no, I'm joking.
Yeah, pretty much. What is your turn on? What gets you going in the morning?
What kind of turn on are we talking about?
So we'll frame this up. You've had a long day. You've done projects. You've been shooting for 18 hours. You've had like 4 hours of sleep, and you've got another 18-hour day. When you open your eyes, what is your turn on? What says, I'm ready?
Oh, just potential. What the f- can happen today? Yes. Like, what is out there that I haven't learned yet? What can I discover? What can I be? How can I push myself?
Your joy for living.
Yeah, just like, hey, I mean, we all get to that point where we're like, maybe it's time, or I can't do this anymore.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God. But much like you say when you wake up in the morning, my ultimate vision and the thing, it hits me like a soccer ball in the face every morning. It's like, get up, gotta keep going.
Love it.
And that's my experience, is every morning it's like, I've got to do it. I can't not do something.
You're hungry for it.
I'm very hungry for it.
Love
and
it.
If I just said can't.
That's all right, we'll splice that one out. or make it a blooper.
But I won't. Yeah, what really gives me my push is if I don't do something, that is what I fear, not doing something.
Right. It's almost like you forgot to do your homework and you're going to class and you're like, oh my God, I forgot to do my homework. There's that weird feeling like because you are meant to be doing these things.
Yeah, if you don't do them.
And you know, it's okay to take day off, whatever, but when you actually set that that intention aside and not let it produce, it feels uncomfortable.
Well, I say that there's a responsibility mm-hmm. to your gifts and talents.
To yourself alone. For no one else.
Yes, absolutely. And I think being authentic, true to yourself means whatever you know that God's given you to do or that passion inside of you, you have a responsibility
yes.
to that, putting that out in the world so it connects with other people.
And it makes you a better person.
Yes, it changes you. It's for you as much as it is for them.
So what is your turnoff? So you're going throughout your day and something happens, someone says something, like in real estate, it's complacency. So what is your turn off?
For me personally, if I'm not growing or learning, I have to like research something or be learning something. I'm always asking questions
yes.
and trying to, like, I have constantly got to be growing or learning
yes.
something. So
I agree.
I'll feel like a loser if a Sunday goes by and I haven't done something productive.
Right.
And I've got to, like, literally stop myself and make sure that I take a day off where I'm not doing anything and I'm basically brain dead, like, to rest. Because, you know, even like, I always say I identified with Michael Jackson having to be put down every single night for sleep, because how do you turn this off when you're right. that driven and you're thinking and the creativity and
yes.
it's constantly, and you're being used as a channel and all of this stuff is constantly coming through. It's like, how do you turn that off? I understood that. I was like, God, man, I'd love to be put down like that every night just to
right.
shut off. So I try and do that on Sundays, but, and when I do that, I feel like a loser if I haven't done something that
yeah.
is what I'm learning and doing something.
And you're very receptive of energy. Mm-hmm. So part of you, I think, picks up on the fact that your skills are needed, and it's hard for you to sit back and turn that off when you know so much is needed in today's environment.
You just made me realize something in saying that, and I appreciate you. It is true, and so many other people need that. There mm-hmm. is a pulling.
Mm-hmm.
There is an energy tug on you
mm-hmm.
that is saying, you know, you got to keep going. There's so many other people that
time.
They need you.
This is your
There's
time.
Spirit, whether you yes. met or not yet.
Yeah.
That's going to tug on mm-hmm. you. And so that is very interesting a way to look at.
So let's talk about, and I'm curious to see what this is because I don't remember what you said. What is your favorite noise or sound?
I love birds.
Birds.
I love listening to the
yes.
birds.
Yeah, especially in the morning, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. They're singing.
Yeah, they're singing, they're talking. I think that calms me for sure.
Birds singing and talking is a sense of community. Community gives us what we're supposed to be doing, socialization, and they're bringing each other up and everything around them. So that's why. You're a bird, too. You do the same thing. What is your least favorite noise or sound?
The dentist. I know that was my last answer.
Yes.
That is
yes.
just does something to me.
I think all of us.
I can't even people that take a bite with their fork and their teeth.
Oh, I can't stand that either.
That. It's like, don't
do
that.
Not
don't be one of
those people. Scrape your teeth on the, please.
No. Please. But that just like, it does something. It does something to me.
Totally.
But let me ask you a question.
Okay, go ahead.
You've changed so much over the
yes.
last like year and a half.
Yes.
2 years. I mean, you seem like you've really stepped into your sexy and
mm-hmm.
your divine.
My divine self.
Uh-huh. So what transpired for you? What made you kind of like?
I would say my biggest change is tapping into my gifts that for the longest time I believed were not there. And allowing myself to deeply study the metaphysical, going to Delphi Metaphysical University, and letting go of the bullshit that was around me 24/7. I don't care about a bigger house. I don't care mm-hmm. about a car. That's geography. That's material. What I care about is making sure that everything on the inside starts blooming
mm-hmm.
on the outside. Because my gift is the face of love.
That's awesome.
And I truly believe, similar to you, that I am here to remind the world what love feels like.
Good.
Because without love, there is no joy.
Because there's, you know, you probably irritate a lot of people because you're
Don't
in
care.
That. But you're in that.
Yes, yes.
And that is where they lack. I mean, we all have an audience. And I don't think that there's enough leaders to step on stage or to step up and do these types of things.
Yep.
There's so many people out there that want to grow, need to grow, that are followers. don't necessarily want to be a leader. So the platform is desperate for a lot of people that actually will step up and step into. And I think that either, I mean, you have to love yourself in order to put yourself out there and be vulnerable. But I have seen you grown, grow a lot. And
well, you've helped, like I said, I've had some bumps, but it is a combination of being vulnerable and allowing yourself to admit that you need help, to admit that you have to save yourself, you have to heal yourself, but you need the tools to do that. You can't just YouTube, okay, how do I find my inner self? That's not how it works. There is a long process. It's been years of chipping away at that crust, and I have emerged.
Right,
from
because
that.
Because over the years, and finally you get to a place where you're
I was a
comfortable
martyr.
In your skin. Yes,
yeah, I was
a lot
a martyr.
Of people do that. The more you are stepping and growing, you're going to piss people off because they're not there yet, or they don't have.
They just need to be inspired to realize that what they are seeing is something they can attain to.
It's freedom.
Yeah, and they can attain it.
Yeah.
And it's not from money. It's not from, you know, producing the best show in the world. It's just from sharing my energy.
And being you.
And being
I
me.
Like to say freedom isn't free. You're going to have to give something up.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, this bottle of water. Hold this bottle of water. Is this heavy?
Yeah.
And you're like, no. Okay, so 3 hours of holding this,
it's heavy.
It's starting to get heavy.
Yeah.
You know, a couple of days and you're like, oh my God, this is our problem.
Mm-hmm.
This is, you know, we hold on to and we don't realize that we're exhausted holding on to.
Because their society tells you, hold on to that bottle. You have to hold on to that bottle. If you don't hold on to that bottle, you have nothing.
Well, we're afraid to even let this go because this is. We want a lot of people, I don't even know why I'm saying this, maybe some out there needs to hear it, but we want justice when we've been wronged. We want fucking justice. How dare you? How dare them?
Yeah.
How dare that? And we want to hold on to that. And what we don't realize is holding on to that is keeping us suspended in that very moment for as long as we are wanting justice. It's just not going to happen. The forgiveness, I call the F word.
Yeah.
Isn't that ironic?
And
but it's I call it the F word because it's so hard to forgive.
It is.
And we got to work on ourselves, but that's for ourselves.
And it's so, I guarantee you, if every single person takes, for the next week, every single negative comment that comes their way or is posted, if they just reply, thank you, peace be with you, not only will it change how they feel inside, but the person who left it is going to be like, oh, well, I wanted a reaction out of them, and they just showed me love.
Yeah, I mean, if you stay in a place, your intention is always what manifests.
Yeah.
So
justice does. I'm sorry, justice in the negative doesn't feel good.
It's never what it is that you fantasize about.
No,
actually, and you know, forgiveness. I also, when I'm coaching people, you know, we've got to go through this. It always comes up, and forgiveness. You know, this is a sign that you haven't truly forgiven. Is when you have to pick up the phone and call that person and let them know, hey, I just want to let you know I've forgiven you.
Yeah.
That's not forgiveness.
You don't have to tell that person.
That's just you trying to have connection. That's just you trying to manipulate. That's just you. That's not forgiveness. Even if it felt good for a second, the moment that you got to pick up and let forgiveness is something that happens inside of you that is for you, that the last person that you want to talk to is the person that did what they did to you. You're so free from them when you forgive that the cord is cut, that it is, they're separate, and you won't do anything to connect with them again. You won't want to pick up the phone.
And it's not necessary.
It's not necessary. It's a sign that you have not.
Mm-hmm.
If you have to pick up and let somebody know that you forgave them, it's a sign that you have not.
It's kind of the concept of, you know, you have to announce to the world how you, you know, donated to a charity and you do subtle little things, including forgiveness. It doesn't have to be to that person's face. You have to forgive them here. Because you are the only one that matters.
It's just letting go of
letting go of it.
The trauma and the baggage and the static and the shit.
And the shit.
Makes us like choose differently.
Yeah.
And when you love yourself, you can't hold on. You work through that. I call it the F word because it constantly comes up where you got to choose again to forgive yourself. Oh my God, let's talk about the stuff that we're accountable for, that we need to forgive ourselves for. I mean, it's really, it's hard for us to forgive ourselves. We walk around with shame about things. And
you have to forgive yourself first before you can forgive other people. Because if you have things you haven't forgiven, it goes back to, if you don't love yourself, how are you going to love someone else? If you can't forgive yourself, how can you forgive someone else? So,
absolutely.
Please, how do people get a hold of you, your coaching program? Tell our audience.
M’Jaie Mangus on all social media. I'm working on my website right now where you can reach my podcast. I'll be coming out with a merchandise line, which is
I love her clothes. Mob.
This is just love really cool and I'm excited. Of course, it's going to be cocky, but it's my intention and everything it is that I put out there is all about love. So just all social media. M’Jaie Mangus or mjmangus.com. And if you want to reach me for even for coaching, then you can
highly
reach me
that.
You can reach me through Kimberly. She knows how to reach me. You can reach me. I'm there. I'm there for you. If you feel really connected and want.
She'll see there. It. She's, she felt me 6 years ago. It was just like all of a sudden, like you called me. You just called me. So anyway, thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you, Kimberly. I love you.
I love you too. This is Kimberly Tocco, Tenacious T. Out. In the right place to move. In the right place for you. Always stay up all night. Watch the neon light. Touch your ones like a number. Heartbeats like a drum. Feed your fantasy. Give yourself to me. Stay in this moment. Just hold on, hold on.